We had the pleasure to inviting Professor Peter Kwong, who's a distinguished professor from Hunter, but also the Graduate Center. And you know, he's best known for his works in Chinese American studies and also Chinese politics. So let's welcome him.
Originally, I was invited, and I said, I don't belong to this group. But I said, well, you know, I should come and see what's going on. But basically, the reason I come is have very much to do with my own background, right? I graduated from Sida Fuzhong. And my undergraduate was engineering at Columbia. The reason I got into engineering is basically like everybody from Taiwan those days, you could only study science, otherwise you're nobody. But then after I graduated engineering, I decided that's not what I want to do. I was interested in politics, so I went into Columbia and got my degree in political science. Now, but when I was at Columbia, it was during the time of radicalism, and Columbia strike. My master essay at that time was Chinese Cultural Revolution and specifically Red Gods. So I spent years reading all these CIA documents at Columbia, you know, all these. So I was very, very familiar with student movement. And besides the fact that I myself was very active in student at that time, I was one of the first Chinese went on to demonstrate against the wall, 1965. I mean, as you know, 1968. Well, anyway, I was active in the civil rights movement, one of the pioneers in Asian American movement. Then I was a leader at the Diaoyutai movement. So as you can see, I was very much, when I was young, very much a part of the student movement. And after that, I decided, you know, I have to grow up and decide to become activist, continue to finish my graduate degree, and working in Chinese communities. And that's what most of my work has been, based on pretty much my activist activities. So anyway, so this is my credential to talk to you. So let me just cut short to basically what I'm trying to say is this. We are basically talking about global capital. As the previous professor talked about, it's a transnational capitalist class. We are talking about the existence of a class transnationally. It's not just in the United States, in China, in Taiwan, and everywhere, right? This is a class has been declared war against most of us, right? That the free trade agreement signing with China is a manifestation. Basically, they have been declaring war with working people everywhere, step by step, stripping their income, stripping their social welfare, stripping their health benefits, stripping public services. All these things is happening. I mean, you know, you live in New York City, you know, rich people gets everything and everybody gets cuts, right? For myself as a faculty, we haven't had a contract for 3 years. And anyway, you know, this is what's going on. So the point here is, if that is the case, right, how do we fight back, right? And here then, I'm going to be very old-fashioned about it, that the most powerful force that is capable of countering global capital is a internationally connected labor movement ally with small businesses, service people, in the case of Taiwan farmers, right? And so if we can build that kind of international connected movement, then we have a chance. Otherwise, we're all divided. Everybody have all these their own specific interests. Now, most people would say, geez, you know, what's the definition of working people, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not going to go into that because this gets very complicated, but I'm just trying to say that we are underestimating the role that working people play. We use the term post-industrial, this and that. Somehow, if Taiwan went to post-industrial or United States going post-industrial, there are no workers left. But workers everywhere. It's just that they are, their role is degraded. They are not respected, right? Nobody gives a damn about them. Whatever they do, nobody cares. So, you know, when you talk about it, workers' movement is never being considered. And it is a result, logically, global capital has been very, very successfully undermining the role of working people everywhere. So I'm not going to go through too much of this, but I just think my own experience, right, working in Chinese community, particularly working in the last 30 years, mainly on fighting against sweatshops. And today, I'm very much involved in anti-gentrification. These are two connected issues. They are both affecting the working people the most. So, my experience working in Chinese community is that this is, again, a tactic by the global capital. That is to say, for the workers in the United States, right, to undermine the workers, it's outsourcing, right? There's another tactic, introduce immigrants and give them no legal labor protection, right? Even better, introduce illegal immigrants or undocumented workers, right? So this is a two-pronged attack, and making the labor as United States casualized, degraded, at the same time, bought over, co-opted labor leaders. So United States, we have basically a very, very weak, very, very, what's the word? Irreputable organized labor. There are all kinds of movements, all kinds of strikes going on. It's not reported. It is not supported by labor. So this is the case with Chinese community. If you talk about labor in the United States, one of the largest percentage, I mean, not sorry, I'm using the wrong word, very, very significant of the laboring class in the United States are immigrants. And they are spreading all across the United States. And it's also in Chinese communities. I mean, you know, with Tiger Mom and all that stuff, will all you guys go to Ivy League? But nevertheless, the question is, significant population of Asians are working people. People working sweatshops, people working in salon, people delivering food, all right? Now, these are the things traditional unions never was interested. This is going way back. 1980s, this is go way back in the 1930s, and my first book dealing with the 1930s. From that point on, ever since 19th century, organized labor has been very hostile to immigrants, right? And never tried to organize them. So the result ended is Chinese workers have problems. They exploited, they underpaid. Overworked, bad wages, all those things happen, right? Now, organized laborers don't care about them, so then they have to be organized themselves. And this is where we see small, independent labor organizations in Asian American communities. This is the case in New York, this is the case in San Francisco, this is the case with Filipino workers, farm workers, et cetera, et cetera. So this is what's going on, that there are labor resistance, but we don't know about it. Most of the, what I, in my book, talk about, uptown Chinese don't care, don't know. Many uptown Chinese go to Chinatown, think this place is so filthy. Why can't somebody clean it? And not really realizing these are very, very important communities. These are the people who work, contribute to the American economy, and they are not protected. So my point is that it is important for all of us to understand whenever there is exploitation, repression, there is going to be resistance. And right now, the resistance is scattered all over the place. And right now, resistance happen outside of context. We cannot understand exactly what causes certain outbreak. But my suggestion to you is that ultimately we have to find a viable way to counter this global capital. And the way I see it is that larger and larger proportion of the world should and will understand that they have to fight back. And even though I'm working in the Chinese community, small community, but the logic is the same. We need to build a much larger movement, not just in the United States, but connected to other places, including Taiwan, including mainland China. One of the things about mainland China, there is a heroic labor movement going on. People always say, well, you know, all these rich people, we always talk about them. But all these years, I wrote again and again, and I read regular on many public press, basically, you know, every year there's tens and thousands strikes, what they call violent mass events. What are they? Mostly are labor strikes. And nobody give credits to that, right? Some of the finest academic social scientists talk about writing about, you know, Chinese workers, they are not class conscious, they're only interested in regionalism, etc., etc. That's all BS, right? I mean, people say, well, you know, in China, if you have one factory strike, but you never go across somewhere else, right? But that's not the case. That the Honda factory struck in Guangdong, Tianjin, other places all responded. So I think my advice to you, I hope that you will look at my history. Maybe you will also go through the same path as you go on, as old as I am. But then we should be moving beyond the questions of outrage, moving beyond this student movement. There's nothing wrong with student. I came from student movement, but we need to go on forward and thinking big. Thank you.